Awesome. So I'm really excited about today's Shark Tank React. And the reason for that is because we're going to dive into Plated. And as an investor, I actually never looked at Plated because I looked at four or five of their competitors during the meal kit boom that was going on just a few years ago when you had companies like HelloFresh and Sunbasket and a whole bunch of others that were entering the space. And we're going to talk about that some more. So let's dive in.
Over the course of a year, how much more is the family paying to eat?
Yep. So here's where I think you're going with that.
You know where I'm going with it.
I have a lot of customers who are grocery chains. The margins are awful.
Here's the dirty secret of grocery. When you start out, the gross margins are actually pretty good, somewhere between 40 and 50%. But then you have spoilage and overhead, and that chews up 95% of the margin.
Grocery store throws away, in some cases, half of the perishable food.
Plated delivers the amount of spice you need and not the $20 jar. You get the amount of basil you need and not a giant thing that will wilt.
Right, so you can make the argument you're saving money because you're not wasting.
We're throwing away less than 1% of what we order every week.
Okay, so here you go. They're trying to show that they've got this like secret that nobody else realizes. And that is that grocery stores actually have high margin, but they have a less spoilage. And what a lot of these meal kit companies were saying too, and they're gonna get into this probably, is that you also have spoilage at the family level, right? Like you go out and you buy that big head of lettuce, but you only needed to eat like half of it and the other half gets thrown away. And so ultimately like you're getting a lot of spoilage and you're overpaying for the amount of food that you're eating.
I think I understand that they've been doing this for how long?
7 months.
Tell us about the actual numbers you had in 7 months.
Our margins today are 40%.
Right.
Those will go to 60% at scale. 350,000 in total sales, but 100,000 of that was last month.
Tell me the projection for the next 6 months.
Calendar year, 2.5 million in sales. And in the next 12 months, we'll do about 10 million in sales.
Okay, so these are like really aggressive projections, right? To go from 100K to 2.5 to 10 million and be doing $1 million a month. Obviously the sharks are interested because like that's really good growth. I wish that they provided a little bit more detail in terms of how they're gonna get there. They talk about 40 to 60% gross margins, and that's actually not like a huge surprise because they're essentially like, I'm taking that head of lettuce, I'm paying a dollar for it, and then I'm cutting it in half, and I'm charging my customer probably like 75 cents for that same lettuce. So I'm basically getting $1.50 for what would otherwise be a dollar. So margins are high, but the problem here that they're not talking about is all the operational expense. So somebody's got to cut that in half. They got to package it. They got to ship it, right? And on top of all of that, they have to spend the money on the marketing to acquire the customer and convince them to basically change a consumer behavior, right? Instead of like going to the grocery store, buying all your stuff, coming home, cooking it, or going and getting takeout, you got to come home or you're going to order this. They're going to ship a box to you and then you're going to make it out of the box. Which isn't like a huge change in consumer behavior, but it's a substantial one.
Okay.
We project $1 million a month in revenue by the end of the year.
So you're ramping up every month.
We're growing at over 40% each.
Josh, how much cash did you have to spend?
All right, so that kind of got hidden, but he says we're growing 40% month over month, which I'll tell you is extremely high growth for any company, right? So like that's a super strong positive that just kind of got like breezed through by the sharks. But yeah, anything probably like 20, 30% month over month is really strong. So to be growing at 40%, like that's super interesting. I'd be curious to know like what's driving that growth. Is it because they're spending a ton on marketing or is it because it's really resonating with the customers?
We just put in north of $50,000 to start.
And then you raised how much money?
To date, about $3 million.
What valuation?
Post money, $9.5 million.
Okay, so let's pause there. What does he mean by post money? Like we don't talk pre-money, post money very often on Shark Tank. Because they try to keep it simple. But Mark Cuban knows that they've raised venture money already in their seed round and that they raised that $3 million at $9 million post. Post-money, pre-money, the pre-money valuation is the company's value before investors put in money. Remember, as a venture capitalist, you're not buying shares directly from the current owners. You're putting capital into the business that will be used to drive growth. And so that's why we have this pre-money, post-money terminology, because $6 million is what the business is worth before the investors put in money, and then $9 million is what it's worth post money. And the idea is that if I give you $3 million, hopefully you didn't destroy that $3 million overnight, and it still is worth $3 million. So that's how you get pre and post money.
So tell me about your background.
I was doing tech startups before, worked in finance for a bit, and met Nick at business school.
Josh is super modest. He's a great engineer, come out of Georgia Tech. Mm-hmm. Spent 5 years building a software business. I went to Dartmouth College undergrad. I did the joint degree at the Kennedy School, Harvard Business School. Went to the Marine Corps after HBS.
Wow.
So
very impressive. Only person to ever do that.
And, yeah. And how long?
You gotta do more with your lives. You haven't done enough. Yeah.
So I did a year active duty. I became an infantry officer, and now I'm still in the reserves.
Wow.
That's great.
Have you considered once you've captured
So really strong team, right? Really strong backgrounds. Obviously, one of them has worked in tech, built products, built technology. The other one has some great leadership and business experience. So I actually think like this is a great duo, right? You've got kind of the technical chops and you've got some of the business chops. Pretty strong team overall, it feels like. Although, it doesn't necessarily feel like either of them have ever built something big. So this is like their first rodeo. That doesn't mean that it's a bad thing. It's just, you know, they haven't been there and done it yet. So there's a little bit of risk there.
Perhaps there comes a week when they're so busy that they need the food prepared.
Totally. Know where you're going with that? The different product lines are 6 months from now coming out.
But there's a ton of competition.
There is a ton of competition.
Sure, but this is about a brand, right? We are building an amazing brand. We put a lot of time into this.
Yeah, but
you guys are obviously really smart guys. But, I mean, I can't go along for the ride unless I buy into the concept.
What are you doubting?
Personally, I love to eat healthy, but I wouldn't order something that I have to cook.
Cooking is believing. When people try this, they come back. This is a game changer because it allows you to have an experience you would not have otherwise.
Okay, so this is an interesting point. And we heard this a lot when we were meeting with meal kit companies, is that what you're selling is not just a meal, you're selling an experience. But the problem is, from my perspective, and this is one of the things that I really agree with some of the sharks on, this whole concept is around convenience, right? Like, I don't have to go to the grocery store, they send me exactly what I need, in the exact portions, and there's no waste, right? It's a very, like, convenient story, but then I still have to make the food. And if I don't do a good job making the food, it's not gonna come out well, right? Versus, I could just go and buy food from takeout, right? And pay a little bit more, but know that it's gonna be made well and I don't have to put in any effort. And I think, you know, a lot of people started buying this and the hope was that people would buy these meal kits and it would replace their groceries. But what it ultimately ended up doing was more like it replaced date night or any other experience that could be out there. And that created real challenges because then I'm just buying the kits on a one-off basis here and there, or I might try it for a little bit, but over time, like either I don't use the kits as I stack up or I get busy or I travel and then I cancel my subscription or whatever it might be. And so it just became like really hard to one, acquire customers, and then it became hard to keep customers because they kept churning off.
You've had great answers. I just can't get over having to make it. I can't invest in something that I would not use on some level.
We'll send you a free trial, and we'd like to get your feedback afterwards.
Send it to his wife. She definitely wears the pants in the family. I've seen
it. My wife wouldn't use it, and I wouldn't use it. You know, for that reason, I'm out.
Okay, so that's like an interesting viewpoint, right? Like, he wouldn't use it, so he can't see it, and he's out.
For the risk that this is not proprietary anywhere, I think I can do the whole thing for $3 million. Instead, I have to pay three times that multiple to play with you.
Okay, so he makes a really good point. And when Plated was one of the very, very first to do this, and almost immediately after they came out, you had a whole bunch of copycats. Because let's be honest, it wasn't that difficult of a concept, right? You set up a warehouse, you buy a bunch of ingredients, you have a line, an assembly line that's like chopping up, preparing the stuff, throwing it in a box, shipping it. Like, at the end of the day, yeah, it's gonna cost some upfront capital. Like Mr. Wonderful's like, it's gonna cost $3 million, but it only costs $3 million to get up and running, right? And so that cost, the barrier to entry is pretty low. I'm curious to see how they respond.
Go find two hard chargers who are smart, data-driven, yeah, and are gonna knock it out of the
we'll
park.
Beat you
like,
to
wait,
it.
We're gonna knock
guys,
it out of the park.
We meet them.
Crush.
We meet them.
You're right.
Crush.
You're right. You're right. Whoever you bring on board.
Enough.
All right, so they were basically like, but we're the team. And he was like, I don't care. I don't believe you. Now look, great teams can make a huge difference, right? An A team with a B idea is gonna figure out how to make the B idea into a great outcome. There are differing perspectives on this, right? But I think in this case, like, they actually do have kind of a strong point, and they're like, hey, we're like a really great team. We work really hard. We're going to be data driven. Like, we're going to bring a certain level of operational know-how or expertise that others won't have.
The trouble I'm having with this is that if you're somebody who cooks, and I think most people in America cook, if you do, you don't really need somebody to send you in a box the ingredients, because you go to the grocery
That's
store.
That's not their customer.
But wait.
Yeah,
I was
it
wondering
is, though,
if it was
Barb.
More urban center.
It is, though. But just think about it, like, instead of going and ordering takeout and eating that greasy thing of Thai food.
But you still have to cook it. That's where I have a little bit of difficulty. I'm seeing it as your customer is somebody who's too busy to cook. So for that reason, I'm out.
So they make a break. She makes a great point, right? Like, this is kind of a convenience play, and yet it's not ultimately it's not that convenient. And this is like, personally, like, I've tried a ton of the meal kits, and the reason we still don't get them is because it's frankly just not that convenient at the end of the day, and it just feels like it's a little bit more expensive, like you're tied into doing it.
This isn't for me. I'm out.
Guys, I would not be a customer. That said, I don't have to be a customer for a lot of things that I take interest in. The real question is, how do you preempt competition?
And I think what Mark Cuban here is saying, he's like, look, this may not be for me, but I think he's looking at this and saying, you're growing 40% month over month. Somebody likes this and somebody is using it. You have a customer here. Maybe this is interesting, but if this is really like taking off and people like it, how do you keep competitors from popping up?
How do you make this so that it's an actual company as opposed to turning it into a feature from any of the high-end supermarkets?
So to touch on that, the back...
Yeah, how do you keep like Whole Foods from launching their own meal kit business, which by the way, they totally did. And that's gonna be ironic, as we'll see later on.
Also, we're signing customers up for year-long contracts.
Okay, tell us about that.
You can either buy just a la carte whenever you'd like, or you can subscribe and save.
And how many subscribers do you have to that?
Okay, so that's a cool idea, right? Like, we're not just shipping off one meal at a time. You sign up for a subscription. And subscription, as we've talked about in other videos, is like the holy grail of consumer products. It's really hard to get consumers to sign up for subscriptions, but if you can, it's incredibly powerful because that means that you can spend a lot more to acquire customers and have the unit economics work out. For example, let's say that the plated work costs $100 per month and I sign up for a year, which means I'm gonna spend $1,200. And let's say of that $1,200, roughly 50% is their cost of goods sold. Well, that leaves $600 that can be used to acquire customers and to cover operating expenses. So on that basis, right, I've got $600 to play with. I can spend a lot of money on marketing. I could spend $200, $300, $400, $500 on marketing to acquire those customers because I know that my math will pencil. And that's a lot better than spending that much money and only getting $100 and really only $50 of contribution margin to play with for a customer acquisition cost. The fact that they have this subscription piece, I think totally changes how Mark Cuban is thinking about this business. Let's keep watching.
But this is another beauty of the business, by the way. We don't need a lot of customers to make this a giant business.
So he's right, right? Just a few thousand paying $1,200 a year, that gets really big really fast.
I'm gonna offer you $500,000 at the $9 million valuation, which is about 5.5%, 5.6%. We'll figure that out. And in addition, I want advisory shares. Whatever the best deal you give to any other of your advisors, that's what I want.
Okay, so this is interesting. So he's offering him the $500,000 that they want at the valuation that they're asking for. He probably knows that he really can't push the valuation down because the other investors would basically tell the company that they can't do it. They would block it because oftentimes VCs will put in provisions that block that sort of thing from happening. And so he's doing it in a like really interesting way where he's basically saying, I'll come in at the same terms that you just raised on, but I want a little bit of an equity kicker with advisory shares. And advisory shares are just shares that a company will give to an advisor as a thank you for being involved and engaged.
So you're talking about 500K at a 9 mil.
What we were looking for
yeah.
at our valuation.
Exactly.
Can we talk about it real quick?
Why do you need to talk? You basically told us this is what you want, so either you want to do business.
We want you to be a part of this. We need to just make sure that our numbers are working with
you. I wouldn't leave that room with that kind of a deal.
Seriously, though, I mean, what am I missing here? Because you said you wanted advisory support.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what there is to talk about because I'm giving you pretty much what you asked for.
Yeah. Happy with that?
Yeah.
Deal.
All right.
Appreciate it, guys. Yeah. I might even learn
super,
how to
pound me. Super
good. Look it out, man. Look it out, baby.
All right, so let's just talk about this deal. So a lot of Plated was, like I said, one of the very first companies to come out and start doing this meal kit. And they grew super fast. There were also a bunch of other competitors like HelloFresh that a lot of people know that also grew really fast. And you probably know HelloFresh because they spent an insane amount of money on marketing, right? Just like I said earlier, they had these subscription models. And because of the subscription model, they knew that they could spend hundreds of dollars to acquire customers, which is why marketing channels got flooded with advertisements for things like HelloFresh and so on and so forth. The problem, though, was that it wasn't just about acquiring the customer, it was about keeping the customer. And churn rates tended to be super high. So at first, people would sign up and churn rates would look really good because they'd stick around for a month, maybe 2 months, but then all of a sudden, you'd hit this like wall and people would drop. And so all of a sudden it became super hard to manage these unit economics where you're spending a bunch of marketing, but you're not making it back up on the revenue over the lifetime of that customer, and became really challenging. The other thing is that ultimately this kind of felt like a fad, right? A lot of people were really excited about the idea, trying it out, experiencing this whole concept, but then after a while kind of got tired of it and went back to what they were doing before. And I think the reason for that is because at the end of the day, this was like an incremental improvement on how we cook and consume food. It wasn't like a totally drastic change. It didn't create enough additional value over the status quo to have staying power. All that said, Mark Cuban did an incredible job investing in this company. So the company went on to raise another $74 million from a bunch of other VCs and ultimately ended up selling to Albertsons, right? Remember what he said earlier, that like what keeps the grocery stores from entering the space? And they said the logistics and supply chain were really complicated. That ends up being actually fairly accurate. But Albertsons looked at this as like, hey, this is a great way to extend our brand. And they bought them for $300 million, which even if you account for dilution, so he took $500,000 and turned that into a very respectable 15 times his investment over a relatively short period of time. So even though like a lot of people looked at Plated and said, hey, you know, you sold too early because you sold for $300 million. You could have been like HelloFresh, which was ultimately worth billions of dollars. The investors that came in fairly early into Plated actually ended up generating a great return. And a lot of the investors that invested in meal kit businesses did not, because these things were just cash hungry and ended up spending a ton of cash and ultimately going out of business. If you enjoyed this Shark Tank React, join me as we review Ball of Angles and their pitch to the sharks.